By the end of this video, you'll know how to 3D model a cable clip in Fusion 360. We'll use parameters to make the model dynamic so you can reuse the model for various cable sizes. Also, during the process, I'll show you a different approach to turning a sketch into a 3D body. Hey there, it's Kevin Kennedy, and welcome to episode number 6 of Practical Prints. Before we get started, I wanted to first thank everyone who has supported the channel over the last year and a half. I've got several Fusion 360 branded items to give away to celebrate reaching 30,000 subscribers. Be sure to stick around to the very end of this video where I discuss how to enter the giveaway. To get started on the model, I've created several user parameters. Now instead of watching me enter each parameter, I've placed a screenshot of the parameters on this tutorial's resource page so you can quickly plug them in. You'll find them at productdesignonline.com/p6. That's productdesignonline.com/p6. Now we'll also want to start with a new component so we can group everything. My first use of these cable clips is to organize some cables underneath my desk. The diameter of the cable is approximately 3 millimeters thick, so I'll name the component accordingly. We'll then start by defining a circle for the cable diameter. I'll hit the keyboard shortcut letter C as in Charlie for the center circle command. Select the XZ origin plane and click the origin point. Looking at the user parameters, you'll see that I've created one for wire diameter. However, we also want to include some extra room for the wire, as this P-clip is going to be clamped together by the screw after the wire is placed. To add the extra clearance, we can type out the wire diameter parameter, the plus symbol, and then 3 millimeters, which acts as the clearance. Now this is to ensure that anytime we change our wire diameter in our parameters, we'll always have at least a 3 millimeter clearance. Next, we need to create the two lines that run from the circle to the right that create that P-clip shape. I'll activate the line tool, and for the first line, I'm going to start at the bottom of the circle. For the distance, I'll use the width user parameter times 1.5. Now you could set up a user parameter for the length, however, I prefer keeping the number of parameters to a minimum and to create functions for various dimensions, which helps keep the model a bit more dynamic and predictable. Another thing we need to consider is how to fully constrain our sketch. This is something that you should always be concerned about, especially if you're wanting to set up your model to be run by parameters. You'll notice the circle is black because it's fully constrained. However, the line I just drew is not. If I click and drag on the line, we'll see that it snapped tangent to the circle, but it can still be moved around. To fix this, we'll need to add a construction line running down the middle of the circle. After activating the line tool, you'll need to hit the construction option in the sketch palette. Select the center origin point and click at the bottom of the circle where the line should snap into place. We can then hit the escape key to clear the line command. At this point, we can use the coincident constraint by selecting it in the toolbar. Select the endpoint of each line, and then, thanks to the coincident constraint, our unconstrained lines will stay attached to the endpoint of the other line, or the bottom of our circle. You'll also see that all of our sketch geometry appears to be black. Now, to double check that we have it fully constrained, we can look at the sketch in the browser. You'll see a red lock icon when a sketch is fully constrained. To finish off the clip shape, we'll draw the second line above the first. Make sure to turn off the construction line and start the line by snapping it into the circle. Instead of adding a length dimension for this line, we'll use the horizontal/vertical constraint to ensure it's always at the same point as the first line. After activating the constraint, simply click both endpoints. Notice how the length of the line snaps to the same vertical point. One of the easiest ways to check why your line geometry isn't black or fully constrained is to move the geometry around. Hit the escape key to clear all commands and simply click and drag the line. you'll see if I select the endpoint on the left that the line can still move freely along the circle. To fully define this line, we'll apply a dimension using the gap user parameter. That way, we can always change the gap of our clip based on our clip size. I'll hit the keyboard shortcut letter D as in delta to activate the sketch dimension tool. Select the two lines and drag the mouse cursor in between the two. Once the dimension is in the correct place, you can click to set the dimension and type out the gap user parameter. The last thing we need to do is trim away the excess part of this circle so our wire can slide into this portion of the clip. I'll use the keyboard shortcut letter T as in Tango to activate the trim tool. Notice the nice preview in red that shows what line geometry will be trimmed away. Simply select this segment, making sure not to select anything else. Before we move on, we want to check one more time that our model is still fully constrained. If you still have the red lock icon, then you're all set and ready to move on. This is where I wanted to show you an alternative method for turning sketches into 3D bodies. Now we could technically offset this geometry, connect the endpoints to create a closed profile shape, and then extrude the profile to create the 3D body. However, that makes our sketch much more complex, consequently making it harder to ensure our model and parameters can be predictable. Instead, in some scenarios, we can extrude this sketch with the surface tool. We'll then thicken the surface to create our desired thickness, resulting in a solid body. To use the surface extrude, we'll first need to select the surface tab in the toolbar. Now the extrude icon is the same as the modeling extrude, but the key difference is the color. The surface extrude is orange. Make sure you're activating the correct extrude command, as I see users get tripped up on this all the time. Remember, with the surface extrude, we don't need a closed profile shape. We can simply select the line geometry and type out the extrude distance. For the distance, I'll use the width parameter. At this point, if we check our body in the browser, you'll see that we have a surface body. We'll use the thicken command from the create dropdown to turn this into a solid body. We'll need to select both segments of faces even with the chain selection option checked. This is because the bottom straight face is tangent to the circle, but the top one isn't, so it's acting as its own entity. Afterward, all we need to do is apply the thickness user parameter, and then we're almost done with the cable clip. The last two things we need to do would be to add fillets to the sharp edges and to add the hole for a screw. Thinking ahead, I'd recommend creating the fillets first because you'll later see that we can use the center point of the fillet radius as a center point for our hole. I'll activate the fillet tool with the keyboard shortcut letter F as in Foxtrot. I'll select the four edges at the end of the clip. For the fillet radius, I'll use the width user parameter divided by 2. Now this function results in a nice rounded edge, ensuring that our fillets will always meet in the middle, even if we change the width user parameter. Last but not least, let's create the screw hole. Depending on the type of screw you'll be using, you may want to use the actual hole command, so you can define the hole type as countersink or counterbore. However, for my desk, I'm just going to use some spare panhead screws that I had lying around, so I'm just going to create a simple circle cutout. I'll use the center circle tool, again by activating it with the keyboard shortcut letter C as in Charlie. I'll select the top surface. As I mentioned a bit ago, you'll see that I can snap the circle to the center point of the fillet radius. This saved us an extra step of having to find the center by creating construction geometry. For the diameter, I'll use the user parameter of hole diameter. We can then extrude cut this all the way through. Remember, we'll now want to use the extrude command in the solid modeling tab, so make sure you're activating the blue solid extrude. You'll also want to make sure that you set the distance to 2 object and select the bottom face of the clip. This will make sure our hole will be cut out all the way through, even if we change the thickness. Remember, the little things like this are required to ensure our model is predictable as we go to change the user parameters. Take note of how our sketches are both fully constrained and simple, and we utilized a small number of parameters along with a few sketch constraints. To test the model, we can open up the Change Parameters dialog. Let's say that we also need to print some out for a 5mm cable. We can change the wire diameter from 3mm to 5mm. You'll see that our length and gap may also need to be updated. We can adjust the width parameter to 11mm. For the gap, we need it to be close enough to the other edge so that it will flex without breaking, so we can set the division as 2 instead of 1.5. Hopefully, this gives you a brief overview of how you can set up 3D printable models that you may need in multiple sizes. By copying and utilizing the same setup, we avoid the need to start over from scratch each time. Now, I didn't have any PETG filament on hand, so I printed several batches of these out in some standard PLA. Although PLA is not the most flexible, it will flex enough to get the wire through, although this may be a concern if the clip were much larger. Now, if you do have PETG filament on hand, then I would recommend using that over PLA or ABS, as it's quite a bit more flexible, and the softer nature of it works well for things like cable clamps. Let's now talk about the 30K subscriber giveaway of the Fusion 360 branded items. Now, the goal of my channel has always been to make CAD education more accessible, so I'm not going to force you to subscribe or to like this video. Instead, I would like your help to continually improve the tutorials and the types of content that I provide. I've linked to the official contest rules in the description of this video, but there are essentially two ways for you to enter your name, from which I'll randomly draw winners for the prizes outlined on the contest page. The first way to enter is to complete the model in this video. Now, it doesn't have to be 3D printed, but you'll need to post a link to a screenshot or image, or the link to your Fusion 360 design file in the comments of this video, or if it's easier for you, you can post it in my Facebook group. To be entered a second time, comment on this video with at least one idea that you think would make my tutorials even better. Now, I'm curious and open to all your ideas, so this could be a suggestion about making more step-by-step blog posts instead of videos, or creating 2-minute quick tip videos, or anything else that you can think of that would help with the greater goal of making Fusion 360 easier to learn for everyone. You'll have until the end of day, Pacific Standard Time, next Thursday, February 27th, to enter, and I'll randomly select and announce the 6 winners in the next YouTube video. Last but not least, I want to give a quick shout out to those who supported my content over the last 2 weeks. Special thanks to my new patrons, Chip Dickerson, Jesse Kelly, Yvonne, Nigel Zett, and Koenig CNC. And thanks to those who supported the channel via my Buy Me a Coffee page. Dennis Carney, Scott Elder, Kurt L., Matt Klein, Ronald Keller, Drew Lindsay, and Dr. Barry Dworkin. Now, if you've enjoyed episode number 6 of Practical Prints, help me out by clicking that thumbs up icon and share the video with someone you know that also does 3D printing. To watch the other episodes in this series, you can click that playlist in the lower right-hand corner.